is staying safe and wishing the same for your families in India. So as you know, we launched 2 weeks ago our 550 campaign, and Radha Damodar Prabhu and with Veena Mataji's support, shared the beautiful flyer on our new build of the temple, and 550. So 500K is what we want to raise in 50 days. We are about 30 days from our goal. And I wanted to first share the excitement that some of our devotees have come forward to in the last week. So Ram Prabhu and Rekha Mataji, thank you very much for pledging 10,000. Raghavendra Prabhu, Chikappa Prabhu, thank you so much for pledging 501. I just want everybody to know, we just want to acknowledge our donors. There is no small or big amount. Everything is big in Krishna's eyes. Prabhakaran Prabhu and Sridevi Mataji, thank you for your pledge on $1,000. And Prashant Prabhu and Meena Mataji, thank you for your $10,000 pledge. So in all, we have made some good progress. We have gone from, starting point of zero, and now we are over 75,000 in pledge from our devotees. So a big Hari Bol to all of you for supporting this build of the new temple in this way. So we are at about 75,000. We are hoping that once we hit our 150,000 mark, we might get a devotee or a person who really cares about the build of the Austin Temple, a devotee from Seattle, who might be able to match once we get to 150K. But our goal for the first milestone is still 500,000. So the way we look at it is, we want all of us to be engaged. This is not something that two or three people can drive. We want every devotee to become volunteers in this fundraising service. So reach out to your contacts, reach out to all your rich friends, reach out to all your devotee friends, reach out to all your friends who care about a temple being built, and approach to them with why it is so important to build a temple. Later today, I will send more of a talking points, which each of you can use as to why it is so important to build a temple. And this applies to anybody who is in the path of devotional service, or even not on the path of devotional service, to see what are the tangible benefits. But I wanted to read a little bit from the Agni Purana. It's chapter 38 in Agni Purana, and it tells you the exact importance of why is it so important and why is it so beneficial to build temples. So Agni said, "I will now describe the fruits of making temples for the residents of Vasudeva and other deities. He who attempts to erect temples for God is free from sins of 1,000 births. 1,000 births. Now, we all know we are carrying sins from millions of lifetimes. So this is a great start for us. And probably, as Rahul Prabhu was talking, we have to build many temples to eradicate our sins for millions of lifetimes. So let us start with this temple. It will eradicate sins for 1,000 births. Those who think of building a temple in their minds are also freed from sins of 100 births. Well, that is really good. But we know millions of births of sins. We want to start big, and we want to, work, take action, not just think. Because in Kali Yuga, action is more critical than our thoughts. Those who approve of a man's building temple for Krishna go to the region of Achyuta, Vishnu, and are freed from sins. So our approval comes with our effort towards building the temple. When we say we are approving that, we put in our effort, we put in our Lakshmi, and we make that progress. Having desired to build a temple for Hari, a man immediately takes 1,000,000 of his generations, past and future, to the region of Vishnu. The departed remains of the person who builds a temple of Krishna lives in the region of Krishnu, well adorned and free from the sufferings of hell. The construction of a temple for a deity dissipates even the sin of Brahmanicide. So even the sin of And we don't know what we have done in past lives, right? Even the sin of killing a Brahmin is dissipated by the construction of a temple. Building a temple, one reaps the fruits which he does not even gain by celebrating a sacrifice. By building a temple, one acquires the fruit of bathing and all sacred shrines. The construction of a temple, which gives heaven by religious or an irreligious man. So whether you're religious or not religious, if you are going to construct a temple, you automatically, it gives you that heavenly planet. Yields the fruit reaped by persons slain in battle undertaken on behalf of the celestials. By making one temple, one goes to heaven. By making three, one goes to the region of Brahma. And by making five, one goes to the region of Shambhu. And by making eight, one goes to the region of Hari. By making 16, one attains all objects of enjoyment and emancipation. So just understand the first thing that we said, it will eradicate a million lifetimes, 100,000 lifetimes of sins. Okay, so we know we don't have to just build in this human form of life. We don't have to build just one temple. We have to build many temples in order to eradicate all our sins. So let us start with this one temple of Hare Krishna temple of Austin and be fired up to be able to contribute and to be able to raise funds. So our job is not just to contribute wealth. Our job is to even raise funds. When I was reading about one thing, this is on building a temple of Sri Madhava. And we know we are going to install the deities of Lord Krishna, which is Sri Madhava. One can attain eternal Vaikuntha Lok. We all struggle so hard in this human birth. But if you look at the 99.9% of the people, our struggle is much less. If you compare our struggle, I always tell my kids, if you were born in Syria, okay, where even a child of the age of five has to worry if I'm going to be alive tomorrow or get food tomorrow. We could have been born, for those of you in India who know Dharavi, which is the biggest slum in Mumbai, we could have been born in Dharavi. But Krishna has been so kind to not only give us a very fortunate human birth, in the human birth, he made us more fortunate by being born in such good families. We are living in one of the best countries in the world, the most prosperous, the most comfortable, the most secure countries in the world. So we even, you know, are even more fortunate, you know, from human birth to being raised in a good family, to living in a good country. And look at our fortune. With all that, we now have understanding of Krishna. We have come in contact with Srila Prabhupada's movement. And this is what Srila Prabhupada told us. Take my movement forward. Prabhupada said his disciples should build temple all over the world. It is an opportunity for fallen souls everywhere to acquire spiritual benefit by participating in and doing charity. If Prabhupada had not built these 108 temples before he left for back home, we would not have got the benefit living in this country. Now it is our turn to pay it forward. We really need to be mindful that there are so many other fallen souls who are suffering, and our suffering is that 0.001%. So we want to share this knowledge. We want to share the spiritual benefit by participating in building a temple. Let us all come together. I know we have made great progress by getting 75,000 in 2 weeks, but keep your eye on the goal. We still have, you know, 300,000 to raise, a little more than 300,000 to raise. So, no, my math is wrong here. A little more than 400,000 to raise. So we still have a big goal. Please, I humbly request everybody who has not, like I said, there is no small or big amount. Krishna doesn't see what you give. Krishna sees what you keep. So open your hearts, open your treasuries, and come forward, because Lakshmi Devi, Rukmini Devi, does not stay indebted to anybody who is contributing for this cause. She will make sure that, you know, this investment of yours, this insurance of yours goes for lifetimes. Lord Krishna has said, this is the biggest thing we can do in human birth, spread Krishna consciousness. And how do we spread? We want to spread in a way that people look at us and say, wow, look at everything they're doing, whether it is spiritual, whether it is education, whether it is meal distribution, whether it is imparting classes on Bhagavad Gita. We can only do that when we have this temple, our dream temple in Austin. You know, I want this Austin temple personally to be the best temple in our area, so that everybody is attracted to it. Today we have 50 to 60 families. Our vision is, once we have the temple, we want 500 families, 5,000 families, everybody coming and saying, you know, if you have to get something done materially or spiritually, the best place to go is Hare Krishna Temple of Austin. So please fire up yourselves. Please take on those flyers and share on your social media posts. Share with people who you know who can contribute, religious or irreligious. You are getting them on that higher platform just by them donating Lakshmi for this purpose. So I'm going to pause here. I want to, my deep felt gratitude to everybody who has donated, but our goals are big. And as a team, we have to attack this. As a team, we have to do this. So please, let's do our service. Let's do our service to Srila Prabhupada. And this has so many tangible benefits for us as human beings, for our future lifetimes, for our children, for generations before and generations after. So it is my humble request. Please come forward and make your pledge. Please take this flyer and go to everybody you know and ask them to contribute. We have to get to our goal. If we don't get to our first goal, we will not have the motivation. We will not be able to keep going forward. And this is a conservative estimate. So please come forward, make your contributions, do your fundraisers, whatever you want to do, and help us achieve this goal. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Swarnamanjari Mataji. Thank you very much for such a heart-touching message. And also the scriptural quotes, very, very inspirational. So we all have to come together and, you know, support this cause and make this happen, the glorious project for the glory of Srila Prabhupada. So that's the message. Thank you very much, Mataji, for that. So with that, Hare Krishna devotees, we'll move on to the next part of our agenda, which is a Bhagavad Gita class. So we have a wonderful speaker today, Her Grace Rasamayi Vishnu Priya Mataji. She is well known. But for the pleasure of devotees, I just want to give a short introduction of Mataji. She is a very humble, kind, and extremely sincere Vaishnavi. Rasamayi Mataji does many services, and she does a festival coordination, which is the toughest service, along with Neha Mataji for our temple. They organize big festivals and work with hundreds of devotees. And she does that so gracefully. She also teaches sloka for kids. Many kids, they learn sloka from Mataji. She never says no to any service because she's very surrendered to the spiritual authorities and her guru. She's very qualified as well, very qualified devotee, but she never shows her spiritual qualification. So it's a very, it's a blessing to have her as part of, to have her association as part of this yatra. So with that, let us welcome Rasamayi Mataji by loudly chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra one time. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Over to you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Hare Krishna devotees. Thank you, Satsara Prabhu and Jai Subhadra Mataji, for this opportunity for serving. Today, I'll be discussing about Bhagavad Gita, chapter 2, verse 14. First, I'll start with Jai Radha Madhava, Samanita.
Jai Radha Madhava, Kunja Bihari. Jai Radha Madhava, Kunja Bihari. Jai Gopi Jana Vallabha. Jaya Radha Madhava, Kunja Bihari.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, can you let me make a co-host so yes, that I can share the screen? Thank you, Prabhu. Can you see my screen, Prabhu?
Yes, Mataji.
Yeah. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. This is verse number 14 from chapter 2. Matra sparshastu kaunteyam shitoshna sukha dukkhadaha Agama payeno nityaham tam stitikshasva bharatam matra sparshastu kaunteyam shitoshna sukha dukkhadaham agama payeno nityaham tam stitikshasva bharatam matra sparshastu kaunteyam Shitoshna sukha dukkhadaha agama payino nityaha tam sitikshasva bharatam. If anyone want to recite, can recite. Prabhuji's, Mataji's and kids.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Can I?
Sure, Mataji.
Can I recite?
Sure, Mataji, please.
Matra sparshastu kaunteya sitoshna sukha dukkhada agama payino nitya tamastikta svabharata.
Thank you, Rani. Thank you, Rekha Mataji.
Mataji, I can do, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji. Please do.
Matra sparshastu kaunteya Siddhosana sukha dukkada agama payeno nityas tam stitikshava bharata.
Thank you, Atmama Mataji.
Matra sparshestu kaunteya siddhosana sukha dukkada agama payeno nityas tam tatiksha bharata.
Anyone still want to know?
Matra sparastu kaunteya stosna sukha dukkada aham payayeno nityas tam stiksha Barada Sarimataji.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Matra sparshastu kaunteya sitoshna sukha dukkhada agama payino nityas tam stitikshava bharata.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Matra sparshastu kaunteya sitoshna sukha dukkhada agama payino nityas tam stitikshvasya bharata.
Thank you, Prabhu. Okay. I'll read whatever translations. Matra sparshaha. Sensory perception. 2. Only. Kaunteya, O son of Kunti. Shita, winter. Ushna, summer. Sukha, happiness. Dukha, and pain. Daha, giving. Agama, appearing. Apayinaha, disappearing. Anityaha, non-permanent. Tan, all of them. Titikshasvam, just try to tolerate. Bharata, O descendant of Bharata. Translation by Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada ki jai. O son of Kunti, the non-permanent appearance of happiness and distress and their disappearance in due course are like the appearance and disappearance of winter and summer seasons. They arise from sense perception. O son of Bharata, and one must learn to tolerate them without being disturbed. In the proper discharge of duty, one has to learn to tolerate non-permanent appearances and disappearances of happiness and distress. According to Vedic injunction, one has to take his bath early in the morning, even during the month of Magha, January to February. It is very cold at that time, but in spite of that, a man who abides by religious principles does not hesitate to take his bath. Similarly, a woman does not hesitate to cook in the kitchen in the months of May and June, the hottest part of the summer season. One has to execute his duty in spite of climatic inconveniences. Similarly, to fight is a religious principle of Kshatriyas. And although one has to fight with some friend or relative, one should not deviate from his prescribed duty. One has to follow the prescribed rules and regulations of religious principles in order to rise up to the platform of knowledge. Because by knowledge and devotion, only one can liberate himself from the clutches of Maya, illusion. The two different names of address given to Arjuna are also significant. To address him as Kaunteya signifies his great blood relations from his mother's side. And to address him as Bharata signifies his greatness from his father's side. From both the sides, he is supposed to have a great heritage. A great heritage brings responsibility in matter of proper discharge of duties. Therefore, he cannot avoid fighting. Let us discuss this verse in detail. I'll offer my prayers to the gurus. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Chalakaya Chakshurun Melitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangam Langayate Girum Yat Krupatamaham Vande Shri Gurum Dina Taranam Jai Shri Krishna Chai Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prashtaya Bhutale Srimate Jai Prabhupada Swami Tinamini Namacharya Pradaya Nitaya Krupa Pradaya Gaura Katada Madaya Nagara Grama Tarani Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prashtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Tinamini Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharani Nirvishesha Sonivadi Paschati Vesatharani Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Brinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So the background is Arjuna, even though he has killed in the battlefield, he is confused whether to take part in the war or not. And he gives various reasons. He gives various reasons saying that if I kill my relatives, I'll not be happy. Or my grandfather, teachers, they are worthy of worship of me. How can I kill them? So he gives various reasons. Even though he is very skillful, he's a great warrior, he's kept in the state of confusion. So Arjuna is a great warrior. Arjuna is very intelligent. He knows the religious principles, but still he is kept into confusion by the Supreme Lord. He just wanted to let every one of us to know about confusions in our life, to clarify every one of us. So why Arjuna is not able to do the war? Because he is not convinced the purpose of the war. So when someone is not convinced what is the purpose of the activity they're doing, they cannot do it. So Krishna spoke Bhagavad Gita to convince Arjuna of the purpose of the war. The more one gets convinced, the best they can do, the best effort they can do. So in this way, Arjuna, Krishna wanted to give inspiration to Arjuna to perform the duties, also to develop, to get back. Like when someone is falling back, how we can get back to overcome the obstacles. So Arjuna is Parantapa. He's a chastiser of the enemies. He can control the wind also. But now he is not able to control the mind, thinking of the bodily conception of his dear ones. So that is the main reason for confusion. Also, Arjuna has a skill to take part in the war, but he doesn't have the will to do it. So this state of having skill but not having will to perform is a state of depression. So Arjuna, Krishna also spoke Bhagavad Gita to remove depression in everyone's heart, in everyone's mind. So now in this particular battlefield, in this so the Arjuna wanted to remove the depression. Krishna wanted to remove the depression of Arjuna in the battlefield, because Krishna knows Arjuna's will. Krishna knows Arjuna's mind. So he started giving the instructions. So Krishna literally spoke from the second chapter. So one of the instructions, which the first instructions which Krishna gave Arjuna to was not to lament. Arjuna, first don't cry, do not lament. Krishna don't want any living soul, every living entity to suffer or cry or lament. So the first one of the first instructions that Krishna gave was in chapter 2, verse 11. The verses, Shri Bhagavan Vacha, Ashochyan Anvashochastvam, Pregya Vadamscha Bhashashe, Gatasunagato Asumscha, Nanu Shochanti Panditaha. So Krishna is telling Arjuna, you spoke like a wise person, that you speak as if you know everything, but it is not looking like wise, because the wise people will not lament either for the living or the dead, because a wise person knows that the constitutional position of any living entity is a spiritual, and it will not have any stopping. Like it is not temporary, it is eternal. So those who know this fact, they will not lament that my loved ones will not be there, or I cannot take up my duties. So so Krishna wanted every one of us to be happy. He makes all the efforts, he makes all the trials to give us this message, and he wanted every one of us to understand this message. So the last instruction which Krishna gave to all of us, and like in through Arjuna, was surrender everything to him. So it is in 18th chapter, 65th verse. Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam braja, aham tvam sarva papebhyo moksha ishyami mashuchaha. Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. I shall deliver you from all the sinful reactions. Do not fear. So Krishna is telling that just give up your ego. Just give up your superiority. Give up the religion. And give up all the fears. Surrender unto me. I'll remove all the sins. I will take you to my abode. I will take care of you, everyone. So this is the instructions. So the first instruction is that not to lament. And the second and the last instruction of Bhagavad Gita is just surrender on to Krishna. Give up all the activities and surrender on to him. Because of the wrong illusion of identification with the body, the living entities have established their own rules. We don't know what is the actual goal of the life. So Krishna is telling, just surrender everything to me. Do not lament. I'll take care of everything. So every life of any living entity is characterized by certain aspects. The life of the demigods is characterized by happiness. Animal is characterized by, demigods will always be in the mood of enjoyment, happiness. Animals, they're characterized by fear. They don't know which other animal will come and kill it. So, and humans, and we are under illusion. So all these factors will be spiritualized when, and we will come out of fear or illusion by listening to the transcendental vibration of Hari, Hari Katha. So it will remove all aspects of illusion, fear, and lamentation. So Arjuna has got a confusion there in the battlefield, whether to fight or not. So the same way in our human life, we also have a confusion because we don't know what is the goal. So Krishna establishes the goal in Bhagavad Gita that the ultimate aim of every living entity is the spiritual realization and go back to Godhead. So when one fixed to this goal will be free from all these miseries. So to give all the, in order to come away from these miseries, we have something to be followed. So in this verse, Krishna gives the main teaching. Bhagavad Gita teaches us to come out of all illusions. So the first teaching Arjuna got from Krishna is through this verse, that is tolerance. Krishna says, titikshasva. Titikshasva means to tolerate. Just try to tolerate. The sufferings will be there, but we have to tolerate. So how? We should tolerate, develop tolerance, because no relation can sustain without tolerance. It is impossible to do anything consistently without tolerance and forgiveness. So in order to fight in our life, the daily, or do any activity, we should be motivated by certain different levels. Like either we should be motivated by fear that if I don't do that, I may not be performing my prescribed duties, or desire, like I wanted to do this to attend the spiritual platform, or any other goal. And the next one is duty, the prescribed duty, the dutiful attitude. When we do anything in dutiful attitude, it gives us the motivation. We know clearly Krishna has given this duty to us. We have to fulfill it. If we are in that sense of duty at full attitude, we can do all our prescribed duties well. And the next one is love. Love is the most highest motivation. Love can inspire us. So the love can towards the Supreme Lord. So if we love someone, we will be happy when we see the smile on their face. So the same way, this love towards Krishna, without expecting anything in return. So when we are inspired by these highest factors like duty and love, we can certainly have tolerance. So Krishna is again saying that, be tolerant, be tolerant. Whatever it is happening, this is just for the sensory perceptions. There is something inside everyone's heart, that is soul. It is not being affected. Whatever is happening, it is just to the body. So, the body is not permanent. So tolerate it, tolerate. So when we tolerate it, the eternal spiritual soul, which is residing in everyone's heart, that will be happy. So this is, let us go deep into the verse. Matra sparshaha means sensory perception, the feeling when the senses interact with the sensory objects. to only this suffering, either happiness or distress. This is only to the body. Kaunteya, O son of Kunti. Krishna is addressing Arjuna as son of Kunti. Shita, winter. This winter will feel cold, deep, like in peak winters, snow, storms. But that will be only for the skin. And when we take necessary precautions, we'll be saved. And that is not permanent. Again, another season, summer, Ushna, summer will come. So, and this summer also will not, even though it is peak hot, still it will not stay forever. So, sukha, happiness, dukkha, pain. So, there can be a chance of happiness or misery. Daha, it will give, giving, it will give to the body. Whatever the pleasure or pain, that is only to the body. So, agama, it will appear. Apayana, it will disappear. Anityaha, this is not permanent. It is just temporary. If you can tolerate for some time, again it will be changed. Tam stitikshasva, just try to tolerate. Tolerance, develop tolerance. Bharata, oh, descendant of Bharata dynasty. So, like Krishna is asking us to develop tolerance. But what is the secret of developing tolerance? So, we have an expectation that every sense that interacts with the sense objects should give us the pleasure. Because of our expectations, we will not be able to develop tolerance. When we reduce our expectations, if we set a right goal, then we can develop tolerance. So we have different senses, sense of vision, sense of hearing, sense of taste, sense of smell, and like comfortable pleasure. So like eyes expect the like sense of vision, like eyes wanted to see everything favorable, which is very beautiful. So this is one of us, like to see beautiful things only is like giving sense gratification to our eyes. So, and ears expect everything to hear about the favorable words. Tongue expect palatable dishes, and with great, and everything should be like with great taste. Nose expects to feel beautiful fragrances. And the skin, like we wanted to feel, we wanted to sit in nice couches, or we wanted to be in a comfortable place. Because we have expectations, because these expectations are there, if something comes in contact to us in a reversal, we are depressed. The main reason for depression is the reversals. Whatever we expect, that is not happening. So, we should train our senses properly and make them understand the reality. So how can how can we do that? See, and now everything is our online world. We see, we browse for the pictures, images, or the magazines, newspapers. Everything they'll put was like beautiful. It is just a painting. It's not reality. We don't know what is happening in behind the scene. But when we see those pictures, we feel, oh, this is very beautiful. I should have that beauty. So when our form does not meet this expectation, we'll be depressed. We will lament. So we should understand the fact that we are aging and this form is not permanent and the form changes. If we can do that, if we can understand that fact, and if we can train our mind, train our eyes to see whatever it is, then it will be, we will develop tolerance. More than that, if we can train our eyes to focus on the beautiful form of the Supreme Lord, Supreme Lord will not age. His form will be eternal. His form will be always beautiful. So if we can train our eyes to see the beautiful forms of the Supreme Lord, the beautiful pictures of Krishna, or the beautiful temples of Krishna, then it will bring joy to us forever. So in this way, we can train our eyes to focus on Krishna. The next one is ears. So what we feel is we wanted, when we hear something, we always think that we have to be glorified all the time. But this cannot be possible. There is no control of what we hear from others. When we cannot control others, and we cannot expect others to speak favorably towards us. So when someone criticizes us, it will be very painful to hear, and it will be very painful to our heart. Then the lamentation starts. So Krishna, in his Krishna Leela, taught us how to withstand the criticism. Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, used to be criticized by Shishupala. He used to criticize 99 times by ill words, but the 100th time he will stop, but still he will criticize. Krishna taught us how to understand, like withstand this criticism. And Supreme Personality of Godhead could withstand the criticism. How can we not do it? So we should prepare our ears to hear anything unpleasing also. But the main, instead of hearing that, training the ears to hear whatever that comes from others, if we can hear the pastimes of the Supreme Lord or bhajans of the Supreme Lord, kirtans of the Supreme Lord, we will lose the tendency to focus on criticism. In this way, hearing sense can be purified. The next one is tongue. Tongue is the main thing which can break our hearts or build our hearts. The words we speak, that can be controlled by sending proper food, sattvic food. So tongue expects the best taste. So if we keep, eat Krishna Prashadam, purify our senses through tongue. So therefore, we should always prepare to speak only pleasing words, at least from our side. If we start that, others may cultivate, taking the inspiration from us. We should always remind that there can be favorable things and there can be unfavorable things. So if we prepare like this, we will get a sort of tolerance. This material world is a place of duality. We cannot expect everything pleasing to us. We cannot expect everything perfect, because this world is such. So Krishna, again and again, Krishna is saying that for everything, first tolerate yourself, because everything is not permanent. Even our life, our body will not stay permanent here. So in this very short duration of time, why to take the things to heart, and expect everything good to happen? When reversals happen also, we should keep our faith in the Supreme Lord and tolerate the things what are coming in our way. So we see, one season will change over the other. Even though we love summer, it won't stay forever. It has its period of time. And winter, even though we suffer in winter, that suffering will not be there. So this experience of changing seasons, we see the seasons coming and going. So this experience of changing seasons give us the hope that the appearance and disappearance of happiness and distress are non-permanent. Agama, they will come. Paino, they'll go. And also Anityaha, they're not permanent. So two days before, we had a pouring rain. And now after 2 days, we had a nice sunshine. So on seeing this, it should give us hope that it is not only suffering for us. There is happiness. When happiness is there, we have to withstand ourselves. saying that because I'm happy today, we cannot expect this. It will be forever. And be joyful all the time. So we should train our mind that be tolerant. This is changing. So one, if someone is in a bad phase, it is just temporary and it will change. With this foundation of this knowledge that the appearance and disappearance of pain and pleasure is like the changes of season, we will get the strength to tolerate. So this is the temporary world, and this is the nature of this world is like that. We cannot help, we cannot expect everything perfect from this, and we have imperfect senses. So it's better to tolerate instead of blaming others. And Austin never expected a snowstorm. Every one of us have suffered either to the lack of water or power and food, but it didn't last forever. It lasted for a week, and everything came back normal. Because we suffered in that past, we didn't stop eating the next, thinking of the past only. The same way, if the happiness comes also, we should not be over joyful for that and celebrate that only. We have to get out of that. We have to understand the real position of our soul here, like the constitutional position of the soul is always enjoyable. But when will that can become happen? When we train ourselves to take to the path of Krishna consciousness. So Bhagavad Gita gives us this reality. And Bhagavad Gita is just a full of knowledge. It teaches us that distress and happiness can come and go every time. Everything is coming is how we perceive with our senses. Whatever is happening is just to our body, not to the soul. The suffering is only to the body. But we should not keep the suffering is only to the body. But we have to make the soul to enjoy the bliss. How can that be enjoyed? How can the soul get the bliss when someone understands the real goal, the spiritual position of the supreme, the spirit soul, that we are the eternal servants of the Supreme Lord. We have to make all the attempts to go back to Godhead. So Krishna is addressing Arjuna here as Kaunteya. Kaunteya means son of Mother Kunti. So indirectly Krishna is saying to Arjuna, you know Arjuna, you saw your mother suffering and she tolerates so many pains. She was widowed at a very young age. She had to bring up 5 children and fathers without father. So she had to see her children. So after training her children to be great warriors, again, she had to see her children together to the forest for the exile. And they lost their kingdom on top on everything else. And she had to see her daughter-in-law being robbed in the court. And also after Kurukshetra war, she had to see that her grandchildren also passed away. And so she had to suffer. I don't think anyone else would have suffered more than Mother Kunti. So you have seen, Arjuna, you have seen your mother being tolerant. So irrespective of any circumstances, you saw your mom had taken the shelter of the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, and she prayed for more and more problems. Why? Because she wanted to see Krishna again and again. So Arjuna, take this path of tolerance. Your mother has set an example for tolerance. Follow that. This is the instruction Krishna is giving to Arjuna, stressing on the factor of tolerance. So we know in Bhagavatam, it is mentioned that Kunti Devi was praying for more and more problems because whenever the problem comes, she can see Krishna. The sloka is this: Vipada Shantuta Shashvata Tatra Tatra Jagat Guru Bhavato Darshanam Yatsat Apunar Bhava Darshanam I can see Krishna again and again. So the translation is, I wish that all those calamities would happen again and again, so that we could see you again and again. For seeing you means that we will no longer see repeated births and deaths. So when we are kept into problems, it is that more purification is coming on our way and we are near to Krishna. So that is how Mother Kunti Devi tolerated all her pains. So Krishna is giving her mother herself him as an example to tolerate. So Krishna is telling, yes, your grandfather, teachers, everyone will go away, but their bodies only will go. This is how you perceive through your senses. Control your pain, tolerate. But you have to do your duty. In due course of doing our prescribed duties, whatever the struggles we have come in our way, we have to tolerate them. And again, Krishna is mentioning. So in also Bhagavad Gita chapter 8, 15th verse, Krishna says, this material world is Dukkhalayam. This is a place of miseries. So we can. So when Krishna himself is saying that there are miseries, yes, there will be miseries. So we have to be tolerant. And this sloka is like, Mamupetya Punarjanma Dukkhalayam Ashashvatam Napnuvanti Mahatmanaha Samshiddhim Param Gatim. After retaining me, the great souls who are yogis in devotion never return to this material world, which is full of miseries, because they have attained the perfection. Because being tolerant, we will increase, like we will step towards the path of perfection. When this path of perfection is achieved, again, we will go to the eternal place. So being tolerant will give us a path to the perfection, the spiritual world. Suffering all sorts of unavoidable misfortunes, one should make progress in spiritual realization, because that is the mission of human life. If we keep on thinking about the temporary problems, if you are not tolerant for the temporary problems, the goal of the life cannot be achieved. So temporary problems, if we make the temporary problems secondary, we'll go to permanent enjoyment, that is spiritual life. So therefore, the so-called miseries are not eternal. The calamities are also called faults. So next word is tam sthiti kshasva. So Bharata, my dear Arjuna, tolerate. Now Krishna has addressed Arjuna as Bharata to remind Arjuna that he had come from a royal family. He had a royal ancestry. Being a Kshatriya, now his duty is to fight, just not to lament. He has a greater responsibility because he has to give protection to the Kuru dynasty and the people around. So to remind this, Krishna has addressed Arjuna as Bharata. So Arjuna, you just have to get up and fight. When someone is coming from a noble family, gives us more responsibility. So here, now we are enjoying the fruits of this Krishna, Hare Krishna moment. So we have a greater responsibility, like Arjuna had, to make the people understand the spiritual realization. So in this way, Bhagavad Gita will teach us everything. So it says that, Bhagavad Gita says that, oh, having skill only will not help us. For the skill to be utilized, we should have a will. So Krishna, in this way, encouraging Arjuna to be tolerant to the non-permanent appearances of happiness and distress. So how can, in order to progress in our spiritual path, we have to control our anger, lust and greed. If we can control this, we can even tolerate the sense of tolerance increases. In Bhagavad Gita, this anger, lust, and greed also, they'll just come and go away. They cannot stay forever if we can control and if we can tolerate. So in Bhagavad Gita chapter 16, it is like mentioned like anger, lust, and greed, they are the gates of hell. It's described in verse 21 of 16th chapter. Trividham narakasyedam dwaram nashanam atmanaham kama krodah tata lobaha tasmadetat trayam trajet. So these are the three gates which are leading us to hell. What are those three gates? Lust, anger, and greed. Every sane man should give up these, for they lead to the degradation of the soul. So if we can control our lust, anger, and greed, then we can achieve the highest goal. So they, and the tolerance. So until now we were discussing about tolerate. But what are those tolerate? What all the things that we have to tolerate? We have to tolerate the dualities, happiness, distress, pleasure, and pain. So one point of time, something can give us pleasure. The same thing in another point of time, it cannot give pleasure to us. It may give pain. So we have to tolerate. The next thing which we have to tolerate is the difference of opinions. So the difference of opinions, this we have to deal with sensitivity. You know, otherwise relationships will break down. No relation cannot sustain if you don't have tolerance. The biggest thing which we have to tolerate is tolerate others' success. Don't be envious. Duryodhana is the main, like the best example for envy. He couldn't tolerate his cousin's success. He couldn't tolerate his cousins being happy. Hence, he devised all the plans to trouble them, which led to the war. And due to his plans, he was only died. His entire family has gone. So we have to tolerate others' success. And in the spiritual path, we also see so many people doing lots of service. We have to tolerate that factor also. These are a few of the things which we have to tolerate. So in our is Hare Krishna movement, our perfect example for tolerance is Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada was at the age of 17, he traveled to United States. He tolerated all the sickness in Jaladuta. After coming here, he had to tolerate the culture, the people, and the climatic circumstances, Shita Ushna, which is mentioned here in this verse. And hence, because he could tolerate all such things, he could establish ISKCON. Because of this, his tolerance, we are all enjoying today. We all get a chance to know about Bhagavad Gita, know about Krishna. More than that, the goal, the ultimate goal of human life. So if Prabhupada wouldn't have tolerated at the age of 70, he tolerated, he wanted to teach us. If he is not tolerated, I don't know, millions of souls, at least me, wouldn't have known this loving devotional service to the Supreme Lord. So when we can understand Krishna, Prabhupada just is fully realized, self-realized its own, that the sickness which he had facing, that is just to the body, but he knows his higher goal to relieve the suffering souls like me and lead them to the path of devotional service. Because of this motto, because of this tolerance, Prabhupada has tolerated everything here, like happiness and distress he had faced, and the climatic circumstances. India is very hot. After coming here, it is very cold. He tolerated that. when no one is supporting him, he tolerated that, thinking that they are anityaha, they are not permanent. His goal is permanent, to establish ISKCON and to relieve the suffering souls, to keep everyone in the path of devotional service. So when this is the perfect example of tolerance given by our Srila Prabhupada. So this is like in the path of bhakti also, we will face so many difficulties. We may feel that I'm chanting, but I'm not getting anything. But no, if we are chanting, we'll not get any, like the fruitive activities right now, it is for a higher goal. So we have to be tolerant. And then we have to be tolerant and we have to teach our senses to be perfect, to lead to the path of bhakti. By following the path of bhakti, we all can tolerate the dualities of this material world and achieve the highest goal, which is Krishna Prema. It is mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, chapter 256, verse, how will a Krishna consciousness person treat when happiness or distress or favorable or unfavorable situations arise? The verse goes like this. Dukkeshvanu vignamanaha sukeshu vikataspriha vitaraga bhayakrodaha sthitadhir muniruchyate. Translation. One who is not disturbed in mind, even in the midst of threefold miseries or elated when there is happiness, and who is free from attachment, fear and anger, is called a sage of steady mind. A fully Krishna conscious person who is surrendered onto Krishna is not disturbed by any effects of the threefold miseries, or he accepts whatever the miseries are coming to his way as a mercy of Lord, and he don't blame that this is happening because Krishna is not favorable to me. No, he will think that whatever is happening, that is whatever is troubling him now, that is due to his past deeds. And he sees that by this grace of the Supreme Lord, I'm getting few problems, less than what is expected. Because Krishna is protecting me, I'm not suffering what I would have suffered. And also, the sufferings are minimized to the lowest. He don't say that Krishna is not protecting. He will say that Krishna is protecting because I may need to have to suffer so much, but Krishna is protecting me, giving me little sufferings. Similarly, when he is happy, he gives the credit to Lord. He will not think that, oh, because I'm doing so much chanting, because I'm doing so much service, I'm worthy of happiness. He'll not think that. He will think that even though I'm not worthy to enjoy, by the mercy of Krishna, I'm getting this happiness. He realizes everything is only to Lord's grace, whether it is a comfortable position or non-comfortable position. So whatever the way he is available, whatever the time is, circumstances are available, he will render the loving service to Supreme Lord. So, he will say, if any pains come in this way, I have to tolerate, because I don't want my services to be disturbed. I don't want to stop my services. He'll be always daring, and he's not at all influenced by attachment or aversion. A fully Krishna conscious person has neither attachment or detachment, because he dedicates his life to the loving service of Lord. So during this process, it is not that he will not get any pains. We will get so many reversals. But still, the factor as mentioned in this mantra, Spashyastu Kaunteya, tolerance. He will tolerate, keeping the primary goal as Krishna, Krishna Bhakti and Krishna Prema. And he will go forward. So success or no success, a Krishna conscious person is always steady in his determination. So to fix the determination, again, we have to have tolerance. Reversals are more expected We cannot expect everything to be perfect in this material world. Our senses are imperfect. Our perceptions are imperfect. So we are suffering. So I conclude this by saying that we have to have tolerance. Tolerance is the main key for anyone to success in the spiritual life or the material life. Thank you very much.
Rekshna Mataji, would you like to take some questions?
Sure, Prabhu, I'll try to.
Okay. Devotee, please ask if you have any questions.
Rekshna Mataji, a wonderful class.
Thank you, Prabhu.
One of the common questions that we get from this verse is, should I tolerate abuses,
Yes.
How do you, if somebody keep abusing, so how much tolerance we should have?
Like, as long as that abuse is not affecting our service to the Supreme Lord, we can tolerate. If it is impacting our services, then we have to speak to the authorities. In this way, we will not, it will not disturb ourselves in serving the Supreme Lord. Satsara Prabhu, can you please add something?
I mean, you said the essence of it. So, and also the tolerance, and just adding on to what Mataji said, Prabhu. So, if there is the basic mental peace is disturbed, that's your limit. And in a prolonged period of time, the basic mental peace is disturbed, then you cannot tolerate. So you have to take some action. The action is always working with, seniors or superiors, however you want to say, and take action like that. So that is one. Secondly, the basic safety is threatened sometimes. Mm-hmm. That you cannot say, oh, I'm going to tolerate now. No, your safety is threatened, that you need to take action. So that is also part of tolerance, because tolerance means taking the right decision in life.
Mm.
Focusing on the right priority in life is also tolerance, so that you won't get distracted by the lower priorities in life, right? So that is one. And of course, the spiritual progress is checked. That we cannot tolerate also. That is called spiritual violence. Sometimes people commit spiritual violence, disturbing your faith and disturbing your things and stuff like that, so that you cannot practice bhakti properly. That cannot be tolerated. But generally the tolerance is it's very like a reflex action kind of. Okay, so I cannot tolerate this. Like that. That's coming from the mind. So that's when we have to take shelter of Guru, Sadhu and Shastra and see what is the right course of action is also. We cannot go with what our mind says. That's why people very impulsive. Then they feel bad. I should not have done that. So tolerance means to control that urge to do something impulsively and process it, then react in the right way. That is also a tolerance, practically. There's some few points, Prabhu.
Thank you. Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you, Prabhu.
But Mataji summed it super well. If something is disturbing your service, then you cannot tolerate it. Mm-hmm. Everything boils down to that.
Right.
Okay, if there are no other questions or comments, I would like to request Neha Mataji to give a thank you note on behalf of all of us.
Thank you so much, Mataji, for giving wonderful class. And also thanks to Samanvita for singing prayers. I want to summarize some of the takeaways that I took. You talked to us about chapter 2, verse 14. That one has to follow the prescribed rules and regulation of religious principles in order to rise up to the platform of knowledge. You also spoke that through Arjuna, Lord Krishna taught us that you may know all about spiritual principles and you may be as great as Arjuna. Circumstances will make you confused. Krishna taught us how to overcome circumstances and not go on the fallen path. To Arjuna, Krishna also showed that having a skill but not having will lead to depression. But if you follow Krishna consciousness, confusion and depression in your life, which is common nowadays, will go away. Krishna conscious people surrender to Krishna because they know Krishna will protect and deliver them. Rasamayi Mataji, you also taught us that through dutiful attitude and love, one can become more tolerant. You also told that we should train our senses to always work towards Krishna consciousness. For example, through eyes, we see things which are pleasant to Krishna, and we should always eat Krishna prasadam. You also told that if you can control three main things, anger, lust, and greed, one can become more tolerant and can achieve the highest goal. And the biggest example of that tolerance is Srila Prabhupada. Thank you so much, Mataji, for this inspiring class, and we look forward for more classes from you.
Thank you, Mataji.
That was a beautiful thank you note. Neha Mataji, thank you very much for summarizing it. It helped me a lot. You really revised the class today. Thank you. So, yeah, thank you, Mataji. So with that, devotees, we would like to make quick announcements, and then we'll sing Narsingarati and conclude our Sunday feast. So I just want to share some thoughts which I shared in the Friday class, and the devotees asked me to speak those things here also today. So today, if you see, we are seeing so many people in India are greatly affected by the second wave of COVID, and that is presently devastating the country. And many of us and our friends may have lost their near and dear ones. I mean, I lost one of my close friends as well for this COVID. So it is very natural for people who lost their loved ones to be grief-stricken. We are human beings, right? So at this time, it is not the time for preaching philosophy, saying we are not this body, we are spirit soul, which is the fact, which is the truth. But this is not the time for philosophy, but rather for showing our emotional support and solidarity with them, the people who are going through that suffering, actually. The grief that is expressed by the human heart at this time, and the tears, at this time are often very cleansing. It makes a cleansing effect in people. So let the expression of grief bring about a sense of closure also. I see it that way. Although the memories of the person will stay on, and there will be a natural sense of deep loss, and the tears by, venting grief help to bring about a sense of closure, actually. So at this time, there may be anger also, the anger towards destiny, how the law of karma works, what is this? And even anger towards the Supreme Lord as well, or anger towards gods, devatas. So this anger should not be taken as a wrong attitude, and it should be understood as a sentiment of heart, and that comes about because of the force of moment or force of time. So we see this in Arjuna also. Even though Arjuna heard Bhagavad Gita and went on with the war, when he heard about the death of his son Abhimanyu, he was devastated and he was infuriated, actually. If you read Mahabharata, you can see that he lashed out at his brothers also. He's saying that, what are you all doing when my son was, dying, actually? You should have protected my son, like that. He used some strong words. So then, of course, he turned towards Krishna also and said, Krishna, you must know all these things. You are the Supreme Lord, Paramatma. How come you did not protect my son? You didn't tell me also about this. It's going to happen. So the reason I'm quoting this is very famously quoted. This incident is the Mahabharata does not consider this to be a defective practice or moral defect to feel compassionate and, grieving for the departed souls, the loved ones, and so on. Krishna does not philosophically try to justify anything. Krishna just consoled Arjuna and staying next to him, being next to him and offering the solidarity to Arjuna at that time. So we can learn from the Supreme Lord himself. So the point I'm making here is that overall, by having a spiritual atmosphere and not so much as spiritual philosophy, that offer a consoling experience, a consoling effect by having an emotional sense of closure for the departed soul and for those around. The experience of death can be made as less agitating and spiritually uplifting as possible. So this kind of a catastrophe is where people say it is just their karma. That is true. But as a devotee of Krishna, our business is to save people, save them from this burning, the sufferings of mental condition. So we should feel for them, give them whatever relief we can give them, help them in whatever ways we can help them. And whatever the karma may be, that is between them and Krishna. So we are not there to judge or justify or things like that. So we can help in whatever ways we can. If you cannot help physically, give them the emotional support and give them the spiritual support. The very brilliant example is Srila Prabhupada. When he came to this country in 1965, he cried for people here. He did not say, it's your karma, so you all are like living like animal. He did not say that. His heart broken. His heart was broken actually when he saw people living like animals. And he prayed for them and he did something about them. That is the true Vaishnavas do. Wherever we see our year of suffering, we should cry to think of people's physical, mental and spiritual suffering. And that should be more of an impetus, you know, for us to do something to help them. That's what we should do. We are Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis. We follow the footsteps of our Srila Prabhupada. So with that said, Hare Krishna Temple of Austin is holding a prayer session today from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. So we request all of you to join the prayer, the prayerful offering of our kirtan, the pleading to the Lord to bring about all auspiciousness and remove all the sufferings from people's lives. So I would like to request all of you to please attend the prayer session today and contribute to helping the people who are suffering. So with that, there are other announcements as well. One more announcement. So this week or last week, we had four birthdays, wonderful Vaishnavas and Vaishnavi, their appearance day happened. So Neeraj Prabhu, Prabhu's appearance day, birthday, Amit Prabhu and Kalyan Prabhu and Suganya Mataji. So for these wonderful devotees, we are going to chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra three times for their holistic well-being. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So with that, our announcements are over. So we are going to sing Narasingharati. And this Narasingharati prayers are dedicated to His Grace Pangajangari Prabhu. He is a head pujari in Mayapur, Narsingadev, a deity. Prabhu is affected by COVID. So let's dedicate this prayer for Pangajangari Prabhu. So our dear Radha Damodar Prabhu will sing Narsingharati prayers. Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Thank you for the service. Namaste Narasimhaya. Namaste Narasimhaya. Pralada laya dhaini Hiranyakashipurvakshaha Shilakankhanakalaye Ito Narsimho Parato Narsimho Yato Yato Yamitato Narsimho Ito Narsimho Parato Narsimho Yato Yato Yamitato Narsimho Narsimho Hritaye Narsimho Narasimha Madim Charanam Prapade Narasimho Parasto Narsimho Narasimho Matim Saranam Prapade Avakara Kamalavare Naka Arbhuta Singha Dalita Hiranyakashipu Anubingam Keshavati
Thank you very much, Radha and Prabhu, for a nice Narasimha Arati. So with that, let us conclude here, and hopefully we'll see you all this evening from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. for prayer session. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.